Welcome to another summer day at Shadow Mountain. We're so glad to see all of you, and thank you for coming today for this very special and wonderful day in the life of our church, and we trust in the life of our nation. We have many wonderful guests with us today, and we do not normally applaud those who come to lead us in prayer, but I know that you will want to give a good Southern California welcome to the man who will pray for America in this service. He's known to all of us through his efforts in his syndicated column and on television. Please welcome to the pulpit, Cal Thomas.
Thank you. Let us pray. Father in heaven, you are the author of liberty, not license. We have loved our country that you helped to establish precisely because it has given us the freedom, the liberty to worship you. And now, Lord, as we gather here in San Diego and in 2 weeks, other Americans gather in Chicago to nominate and then eventually elect those who would lead our nation for the next several years. We confess to you this morning, Lord, that our problems are not in Washington, and they are not economic and political. They are in our hearts because they are moral and spiritual. And Lord, those who belong to a kingdom that is not elected or appointed, a kingdom that is not of this world, a kingdom that does not trust in princes and kings, a kingdom that has no king but Jesus Christ. We acknowledge to you individually and on behalf of our nation that we have sinned greatly and are already under your judgment. And so while we would pray for your choice for our mutual benefit, we would plead with you this morning for our greatest need, which is revival. Lord, no one is going to save us in Washington or in Sacramento. Only by your power will this happen. Please send that power. Revive us again. Heal our land. Give us followership that we might have leadership that reflects your pleasure. We ask these things, expecting you to answer as you have done before, in the name of the one who is not on the ballot, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let me take just a moment and introduce a couple of special guests that I'd like for you to know. First of all, we are so very pleased that in this busy time, she would take this Sunday morning opportunity to be with us. Would you please welcome the mayor of El Cajon, Joan Shoemaker? Would you stand, please? There is no way in the world he would ever miss an event like this if he were within 100 miles and had to walk. And he's our own Duncan Hunter. Duncan, where are you? Stand up. There he is. But let me also tell you that we're very proud of some folks in our own congregation who serve in the political arena, and I'd like for you to welcome Steve Baldwin, who is the state assemblyman here. Steve.
It was a Declaration of Independence that gave us our freedom, but it took the Constitution to give us our nation. It was 1787, a year after the Revolutionary War had ended, when a constitutional convention was called. Now, it was a great idea, but the delegates, they couldn't agree on anything.
Every discussion was punctuated with gossip and wrangling and shouted arguments without end. It seemed as though we were destined to be 13 independent countries instead of one United States.
Well, just when it looked like the great American dream might never happen, Benjamin Franklin, who was then 81 years old, rose and said, "If a sparrow cannot fall without God's knowledge, is it probable that a nation can rise without his aid? I move that we pray."
Struck by Mr. Franklin's simple declaration of faith, the delegates adjourned and went home to think about it, and they did pray. When they returned in the fall of 1787, they wrote the preamble to the Constitution of the United States. Let us recite it together.
We the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America.
Citizenship does not come without responsibility. The high calling of the kingdom of God does not mean that we are to forget the important role that each of us must take in the preservation of our nation's liberty.
The freedoms that you and I enjoy today did not come without a price. There were those that gave of their fortunes and their lands, and those that dedicated their lives to public service.
There were also those who left the comforts of home and family to defend our nation in far-off lands. The legacy of those who were willing to preserve, protect, and defend our liberty lives on in those who serve our country today in the many branches of the armed forces.
The debt we owe them can never be adequately paid or our gratitude fully expressed, but it is fitting that we acknowledge our appreciation and pay tribute to the men and women of the armed forces of the United States of America.
In a moment, Sergeants Nash and Reynolds will be leading us in the singing of the hymns from the four major branches of our armed services, featuring the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, and the Marines. The Coast Guard will be honored along with the Navy. If you have served in any of these branches, we want you to please stand as your song is being sung and come forward for a special presentation, acknowledging your pride in having served your country and giving us an opportunity to express our thanks to you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Sergeants Nash and Reynolds.
Soldier looking good. Ought to be in Hollywood. Army is the place to be. Make a soldier out of me. Best of all, serve my country on the sea, while my sweetheart waits for me.
Say
it's brave and bold.
We who are patriots and believe in the values of this nation have come to love this man. We love him for what he believes, and we love him for the stand that he has taken. I've often been told that you can tell the caliber of man by the people who love him and by the people who hate him. And I've kind of come to the conclusion that I don't very much like the people that hate Oliver North either, so. And let's be honest about it, friends. They don't hate him for anything that's happened in the past. They hate him for what he believes. They hate him for his values. And they vilify him because he's a man who's unafraid to stand up for what's important. He's taken a lot for all of us, and it's a real privilege for us to have him here. I told him at the beginning of the service, Ollie, we did all this front stuff for you because we know how much this country means to you. And now will you help me give a great big Southern California welcome to Oliver North.
There can be no further outbursts like that, or we're not going to finish. And the guy who's coming next outranks me by a considerable amount. I want to thank you, Pastor Jeremiah, for the chance to be back in this beautiful church, to hear once again that wonderful choir and orchestra, and to share with you just for a few moments some thoughts that occur to me on the eve of this remarkable gathering in San Diego. And I want you to know that I'm not going to give a political lecture here this morning. I am probably the only person gathered here at Shadow Mountain that is going to go to both conventions this year. I must go to Chicago to broadcast from there, as I will be broadcasting from this one. And so I'm going to leave the politics to the politicians. And I'm also not going to try to preach a sermon, because I've got two dear friends sitting here in the front pew who are far better than I at that, and certainly both of them have had their experience here with Tim LaHaye and Pastor Jeremiah. What I would like to do is talk with you just for a few moments about the issue of courage. And I'm not going to pretend to try to hold myself up as a model of courage, for I know that I am a frail, flaw mortal who fumbles and stumbles every single day. But I would like to hold up to you a model that is in this book right here. When I came here in 1992, I told you how I came to read this book for the very first time from cover to cover. It is still here 4 years later, and I now at the age of 52 tell you it is the only book that I have ever read from cover to cover more than once. And I have learned some remarkable things, and each time I go through it, I learn something different. And I think this time of our lives and at this point in our nation's history, there is a remarkable example in this book that we all need to reflect on, for it is a remarkable example of courage in a difficult time. The example I use, and for those of you who do have your Bibles, you'll know that I am using the MIV version of the Bible. That's the Marine Infantry version. I am referring specifically to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 8, verses 5 through 13. That's the story of a Roman soldier, a captain of infantry, if you will, a centurion. A centurion was an infantry officer who commanded 100 Roman soldiers. That's why he was called a centurion, because a century is 100. And this particular Roman army captain, for that was the equivalent rank in our Marine Corps, had been posted as the martial law authority in a town called Capernaum. It's a wonderful story, and in the MIV version, it tells us a lot about faith, and courage. And I want to challenge everybody in this beautiful church here this morning along that line. The Roman army captain has at his home a sick servant. We know from the writings of the book that it's a servant who's paralyzed, who is very likely dying. We don't know this from the writings, but we can assume that the Roman army captain has already called in the medical officer from the battalion. The Roman army doctors have been there, and they've basically said there's nothing much we can do for this fellow. He's probably not going to make it. They've probably prayed to the Roman gods and goddesses, all of them, and nothing has changed, but his condition has gotten worse. And at that point, the Roman army captain does something absolutely astounding. The Roman army captain goes out into the streets of Capernaum, where he knows that there is a teacher teaching the crowds. Capernaum is a town of several thousand people, and the crowds gather every day, either at the Jewish synagogue or at the city gates. We know this because there are other writings of the time besides this book that describe the fact that this teacher was being watched by the secret police of the day. The teacher, of course, is this Galilean named Jesus. And what he's teaching, according to the authorities, is nothing less than sedition, according to the authorities. He's opposing some of the law of the land, one of which is you pay absolute homage to Caesar in everything. I want you to think about this Roman army captain and the issue of courage. He is undoubtedly an experienced officer. He has fought the wars of Roman imperialism for years. He's probably in his early 30s. And he has a sick servant. And he's about to do something that places him at extraordinary risk. For he knows that this Jesus person is being watched, and reports are being sent back to Rome. And he makes a judgment call in his own mind. And he says, "My servant's life and health are more important than my future." And so he goes out in the streets to find Jesus. And he sees the crowd. And he comes up to the crowd. Now you have to understand, this was not a character who was necessarily welcome in the community. He was part of the occupying army. He was the martial law authority. He was the representative of the Roman army's imperial government. And he sees the crowd and he shouts out from the edge of the crowd, "Jesus, Jesus, over here." Gathered around Jesus are the 12 who've worn out their sandals walking all over what is today the Holy Land. Does Peter at that point reach for his sword as he eventually does later in a garden? Does the crowd gather around Jesus in a protective fashion? Do they mumble in hostility toward the Roman army captain? Somewhere in that crowd is a note taker, a person who will write back to Rome that an officer of the imperial army had the audacity, temerity, and lack of judgment to approach this Jesus person. And then he does something absolutely astounding. Jesus must have turned to him at that point and said, "Yes, what is it that I can do for you?" "Jesus, I have at home a sick servant, and he needs help. We've tried everything. And I need you to heal my servant." In those words that I've just paraphrased from this book is a remarkable profession of faith. But it gets better. Jesus must say something to the effect of, "Okay, fine, let's go." And at that point, this Roman army captain says, "Oh no, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should set foot across the threshold of my house. I am a person of authority, Lord. I can tell one to come and he comes. I can tell another, go and he goes. I understand orders. And I know that all you have to do is to say the word, and my servant will be healed. What a remarkable profession of faith. In fact, it is so remarkable that Jesus Christ turns to the 12 and all those he is teaching. And he says something that must have hurt to the quick for Peter, James, and John. It must have hurt because he says of this Roman army captain talking to the crowd, "Greater faith than this in all Israel I have not seen. Go, it's done as you ask." And we know that within that hour, the servant was healed. We know that because every word in this book is true. Now, I tell you that story as a precursor to the centurion in my life. When I was here last, I told you about the man who led me to the Lord. I want you to think about that man, a Marine Lieutenant Colonel. I was a major. I was not his servant per se, but I was his subordinate officer in a battalion landing team getting ready to deploy to the Mediterranean. And I had jumped off the back of an armored vehicle, and I had re-injured my back in exactly the same place it had been broken in the automobile accident in 1964 that I told you about, for which I had spent 11 months in the hospital. Exactly in the same place where I re-injured it in a training accident in 1973. And here I was in 1978 laying in the dirt in North Carolina. And the Sergeant Major, Ed Johnson, Battalion Landing Team 3/8 Sergeant Major, Ed Johnson, 9 feet, 4 inches tall.
Sergeant Majors all talk like frogs.
Sergeant Major Ed Johnson called out for the battalion corpsman, the medical chief, to come and help. Get aboard, get a helicopter, get this Marine Major named North to the hospital, because he wouldn't be going on this deployment. And I knew I wouldn't be because I'd lost the feeling in my legs and lost control of my bladder, and I knew I was hurt bad. And the next person underneath that camouflage net was that battalion commander, Lieutenant Colonel John Southey Grinnells. John Southey Grinnells was one of those remarkable men in the U.S. Marines. He graduated near the top of his class at West Point. I'd gone to Annapolis. I was willing to overlook that. He'd been a White House fellow, had been a Rhodes Scholar, and unlike some other Rhodes Scholars, he'd been to Vietnam twice. I promise no politics. And I am trying. John Grinnells said, gotten an MBA from Harvard. He'd been to Oxford University. He had all of what we call a remarkable education, and he was at the top of the list for promotion. And the reason I had accepted the assignment with him as his operations officer was because I knew he was going to be a general someday. And after all, if I could go with him, I'd go right on up the line and be a general too. People used to write of him that he would be commandant of the Marine Corps someday. Oh, there was one other thing I had to overlook besides him being from West Point. He was also known as a born-again Christian. He had one of these books on his desk. He had one in his field pack. He carried it with him, and he used to read from it often. I was willing to overlook that, too. And as I lay there in the dirt, John Grinnells came in and knelt down next to me. I want you to think again of that battalion commander and that centurion of the good book in Matthew. And he knelt down next to me and he said, "I'm going to pray for you." And I actually said to him at the time, "Oh no, sir, I'm hurt bad. Let's do this the regular way." And he totally ignored what I'd said. And he closed his eyes and he said, "Lord Jesus Christ, you are the great physician heal this man. That fast, the pain went out of my back and the feeling came back in my legs. And intellectually, I knew what had happened, but it hadn't changed anything in here. And I got back up off the ground, something I could not have done just seconds ago. And I looked him in the eye and I said the stupidest thing I could possibly say. I said, "Thank you, sir." Sergeant Major Ed Johnson is there with eyeballs as big as saucers. All the young communicators that we've been training for months getting ready to deploy to the Mediterranean to become the landing force in the 6th Fleet in the Middle East were watching. My operations chief, Don Gabbard, stood there with his jaw hanging down. Any one of those young Marines could have written a note to the regimental commander, to the division commander, and said, "We've got a battalion commander who's out there proselytizing." After all, we have separation of church and state in America. We've got a guy who's praying for his officers and healing them on the spot on field exercises. What's this Marine Corps coming to anyway? Think of the jeopardy that Roman Army captain placed himself in when he went and did what he did, not for his own promotion, not for his own advancement, not for his own betterment or improvement, but he did it for his servant. And John Grinnell did exactly the same thing. Lieutenant Colonel, U.S. Marines, Rhodes Scholar, White House Fellow, MBA from Harvard. Same thing exactly. Remarkable courage and remarkable faith. They both risked being misunderstood, rejected, perhaps even court-martialed. The Roman army captain took the risk of being dragged in chains back to Rome and stood on trial, perhaps even executed for it. And John Grinnell's risked being relieved of his command, sent away in disgrace. John Grinnell's, after I said that remarkably stupid thing about "thank you, sir," said to me, "No, you don't understand. You have got to come to know your Savior, Jesus Christ." And I thought I did. I could recognize a picture of him. We even had one of these books, Betsy and I, that someone had given us when we got married. It was on the coffee table in our living room, in our base quarters. But I'd never read it. And just before we got on those big gray ships to go to the Mediterranean to become the landing force in the Middle East, John Grinnell gave me another one. And in the 11 days it takes to go from North Carolina to the Mediterranean Sea, I read this book from cover to cover for the first time in my life. And I suddenly realized the kind of courage that we're all called to. What does that have to do with this day and age? There are challenges today, the likes of which we must confront in faith. There are challenges today in every one of your lives, not just in politics, not just in who we elect as president. There are challenges in your lives. Every single person in this beautiful church knows someone who does not know their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as that centurion knew them, as that Marine Lieutenant Colonel John Grinnell knew him, as I know him, and perhaps as you know him. Every single one of us. I'm speaking now to those who say, "I'm saved." You see, I know I'm saved, not by virtue of all the medals on my chest or all the things that I've done before or since, all the pluses I've put on one side of the ledger to cancel out the minuses. That's the way I used to live life before 1978. You see, this book says none of that matters. What does matter is accepting the remarkable sacrifice of that same Jesus Christ who could heal a servant without ever going to the house, who could heal a Marine major laying in the dirt, who can heal your loved one. But what does it call for? It calls for the kind of courage of that centurion from you, every single one of you. I'm not going to embarrass anyone. But every one of us knows a loved one, a parent, a child, a sibling, a neighbor, a friend, a coworker. Every single one of us knows someone who does not know Jesus Christ in the way this book tells us he is. Every single one of us knows someone like that. And the challenge for you is one of faith and courage. To be able to demonstrate by the way we live, by what we do, by what we say, and how we do it, that there is something much more important. And it's all laid out right in this book. Every single bit of it. There is perseverance. There is persistence. There is faith that can be demonstrated just like that Roman Army captain, just like that Marine Lieutenant Colonel. It is faith to get through the greatest adversity that could ever confront you. Life and death, pain and suffering, terrible tragedy. It's all there. It's not in the book of hesitations. It's not in Uncertainty 2:11. It's all right here in this book. And I challenge you here today, in this gracious welcome before this beautiful flag, after all of that, that everything that we do needs to be a demonstration of courage in this particular day and age. Courage to explain that salvation, that acceptance of Jesus Christ. He didn't just lay down and die. He was tortured to death. He had a crown of thorns jammed down over his scalp till the blood ran in his face. And he was whipped and stripped, forced to drag a heavy tree up a mountain, and they nailed him to it. And he suffered and died so that I, a miserable, no good sinner, wouldn't have to go to hell. And 3 days later, he rose again from the dead so that I could have eternal life. And all he asks of me is that I repent of my sins, accept that sacrifice on my miserable behalf, be washed in the blood of the Lamb, and accept the Holy Spirit. I challenge you to be able to explain that to those you love who do not know him that way. I challenge you to do that, because if you can do that, so much else of life is understandable. You know, in Romans 8:28, in the MIV version of the Bible, it says, "It's not your plan, North, it's mine. Get with it." I didn't understand that either. And if I hadn't understood it come the summer of 1987 with all of what was going on in Washington, there would be no way in which my family and I could have gotten through it. And I want to challenge you that there is in this book everything that you need to know. I want to leave you with one last thought. When things aren't going quite the way you expect or want or would hope or have even prayed, because you see, it also says in this book, God is rarely early, but he's never late. It says in this book that there is enough there for whatever shall happen to you. I want to leave you with one last thought. On that very first morning of those remarkable hearings in Washington, gathered in that room with all the Roman emperors up there on the dais, I was brought into the holding room by a security team, and they encircled us. And we had just a few minutes. They said, "We want to clear the hallway and make sure that everybody is gone before we move you across the hall into that hearing room." And so Brendan Sullivan, the attorney, and I were brought into that room and held. And I got down on my knees and I said, "Oh, Lord God, if there is ever going to be an earthquake in Washington, let it..." I said, "Lord," all I had time to say was, "Lord Jesus, help me. I don't know what's going to happen in there. Please help me." And then came the knock on the door. And the security guards had formed a double cordon. The civilian-clad guys with the guns in their pockets, and outside that, the Capitol Hill police, and they'd emptied the hallway to move us the 30 feet across the hallway. And as we're moving in the middle of that cordon, through that double circle of armed men and women, comes a little lady who puts a card in my hand. Bursts right through it. Does make you wonder how good they really are, doesn't it? She puts this card in my hand, and Brendan Sullivan, always the lawyer, grabs the card out of my hand and puts it in his pocket. He says, "Look, son, don't be reading other things. Just pay attention to what is going on inside the room. Read the things they give us." But when he got there, he sat down and he put this card right in front of us, propped it up on the microphone stand. And each time we'd get up to leave, he'd take the card and put it back in his pocket. Well, I will tell you, this was driving the so-called media nuts. Because down in front of us was a pit where all the photographers were and the TV cameras. The guys with those motor-driven cameras that every time you'd pick your nose, they'd shoot 60 frames. And by the third day, this was driving him crazy, because every time we'd come into the room, Sullivan would take this card out and prop it on the microphone stand, then he'd put it back in his pocket. And from up there in the raised dais, the emperors were looking down going, "What is that? What's he got on that card?" One of the reporters, about the third or fourth day, came up to Sullivan just after he'd put it in his pocket. And he said, "Sullivan, quick, before we get out of the room, before the security guys get here, I've got to know what is on that card." You know, inquiring minds need to know. Sullivan took the card out of his pocket, looked at it, and in response to the reporter's question, as he put it back in his pocket, the reporter said, "What's on the card?" Sullivan looked at it, put it back in, and said, "The answers." This is that card. This is why you should have the courage of a centurion. This is why you should never hesitate to stand up and speak out forcefully on issues, yes, in politics, and issues of faith, the sanctity of human life, the importance of doing the right thing, and demonstrating your faith to that loved one that you know in your heart does not know Jesus. This is all the courage anybody needs. For this is that very card that that little lady who I've never seen since and had never seen before put in my hand. And Sullivan gave it back to me at the end, tucked into a copy of the Constitution of the United States that has that preamble we saw up on these screens that we recited together. This is that card. Oh, what does it say on it? Oh. "They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not feel faint." Isaiah 40:31. Sullivan was right. These are the answers. God bless you.
You know what? If he keeps practicing, he's going to get pretty good, isn't he? You know, he doesn't have to apologize for that message. That's the best presentation of the gospel I've heard in a long time. Amen. And I want to say to you that if you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you need to trust him. You can do that wherever you are by just asking him to come into your life and forgive your sin, as Oliver expressed. He will do it. He can say the word, and you will be cleansed and clean. And then find somebody you know who is a Christian and go tell them what you've done. Tell them that you've put your trust in Christ. And if you need some help, you come and see one of us. We'll help you. Because knowing Jesus Christ is far more important than anything you will ever do in this life. And you get not only what's meaningful in this life, but you get the next life as well.
now let us recite together the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I read with interest all of the information about our speaker today, and I could not even begin to touch on the accomplishments of this man's life. One of the youngest vice presidents ever to serve our country, elected to the Congress at a very, very young age, and continues to have a great influence in our country. But I'm not going to tell you about all of those things. I'd like to tell you about him as my friend, because we're fellow Hoosiers. And way back, a long time before he was in public office, I was a young starting up pastor at the Black Hawk Baptist Church in Fort Wayne, Indiana. Dan and I got acquainted, and we had some wonderful days together. In fact, he was reminding me in the green room that we shared some events like this on the 4th of July that we used to do back in Fort Wayne. But the story I'd like to tell you before I formally introduce his family and him is that during one of his early campaigns, we had the opportunity to interview him at our church. Back in those days, the Black Hawk Baptist Church had just inaugurated its television service that originated from the sanctuary of our church. And believe it or not, it was live. It was on Channel 21, the ABC affiliate in Fort Wayne, WPTA. And I was trying to do everything I could to influence what was going to happen in the next few days without getting myself in trouble. So I invited Dan Quayle to come and be my guest in the Sunday morning service just a few weeks, I think maybe 3 weeks before the election. And I had him come to the pulpit, and we carried on a conversation, and we talked about a number of things. But the first question I asked him was about his faith in Jesus Christ, which he answered very forthrightly. Well, I walked out of the pulpit that day, and before I got to the back door, the producers of our program were getting hold of me saying, "You are in big trouble. The phones at WPTA have lit up. The other party is absolutely furious. They're demanding equal time. They think this was..." I didn't know what to do. So the next day, the Lord gave me this inspiration. I called the person who had left his number, and I said, "We would like to invite you to be on our telecast next week. And I want you to know that in complete fairness, I'm going to ask you exactly the same questions." And if I remember correctly, he said, "We'll get back to you," and I'm still waiting for the call. I don't know of any family that has been through more for the things that are right than this family has. And we count them as not only dear friends, but as great heroes of ours. We love them. And before I introduce our speaker today, I would first of all like to introduce his wife, Marilyn, who is here with us. Marilyn, let's welcome her. And I won't say anything to embarrass him, but when I saw him the last time, I would not have recognized him. This time, Tucker has grown up. Would you welcome Dan and Marilyn's son, Tucker? Where are you, Tucker? A few weeks ago, we had a special series of messages here at the Shadow Mountain Community Church on the family. And one of the messages was entitled, "Dan Quayle Was Right." And then I preached another message entitled, "Murphy Brown's Folly." And both of them were well attended, I want you to know. But the fact of the matter is, friends, Dan Quayle was right. And he is right. I know that you'll want to join me in welcoming to this pulpit Vice President Dan Quayle.
Thank you all very much. Well, thank you for that tremendous welcome, just like Blackhawk Baptist Church in Fort Wayne, Indiana, right? But good morning to each and every one of you, and David, and to Donna, too. It's great to see two friends. You know, you took me back a few years there, David. You said way back when. Do you realize it was 20 years ago when I first ran for Congress? I was young then, too. I think David and I have fully recovered from that. But we are just thrilled to be in your church. And I do remember that story so well when you offered equal time to my opponent. Now, Duncan Hunter, where are you? There you are. If you get invited up here, come. My dear friend Duncan Hunter, who is the congressman from here, and I was kidding David in the green room earlier, that I was his congressman and David Jeremiah was a constituent of mine. And so I served David Jeremiah just like Duncan does. And Duncan, I want you to know, I worked very, very hard to try to get his vote every single election. But my dear friend Cal Thomas, thank you for a very inspirational prayer, and of course his lovely wife, Ray. David, you may not know this, although I'm sure we talked about it at one time. My great-grandfather was a Methodist minister, an itinerant Methodist minister in the state of Kansas. And my mother, she always wanted somebody, one of her four children, to go into the clergy. And look what I chose. But I want you to know, for a Presbyterian, I feel very welcome in this Baptist church. As Marilyn and Tucker and I were traveling here this morning, I couldn't help but think of one of my very favorite stories. It was about a man who asked his friend whether he believed everything in the Bible. The man didn't hesitate. He said, "Yes, I do. Every single word." And his friend, amazed at the man's conviction, asked him why. "Why would you believe every single word in the Bible?" And the gentleman spoke from the heart, and he said this, "Because I know the author. And I believe everyone in this room today knows the author." Now this morning, and I'll tell you, it's difficult to do after this tremendous presentation David referred to, the patriotic day that we used to have at Fourth of July at Blackhawk. But this was spectacular. David, you've gotten a lot better, or you, the people have. Or maybe the people have just gotten a lot better compared to good old Fort Wayne, Indiana, but I was... You know, it'd be easy for me just to stand up, "Cal, you'd appreciate this." Well, no speech. Everybody feels good, right? Great singing, and we honored those who'd served and all of that. We'd just go home, have a wonderful family day, come back at 6 o'clock, and that'd be the end of it. But my message will be optimistic because I believe in America. I believe in this country. And as Cal Thomas said, he is the author of liberty. And it is our liberty and our freedom to choose and to make this country to continue to be the greatest country the world has ever known. But my friends, let us reflect for a moment, because we have a very steep hill to climb. We have many challenges today. Sure, in material beings and material wealth, who can challenge the United States of America? Look at where we are on a per capita basis. Our GDP is greater than any country in the world. We have more TVs, VCRs, computers, better cars, better homes, you name it, than anywhere in the world. But despite our vast material wealth, something seems to be missing in our culture. Ask yourself how good you feel about things inside. Sure, outside may look fine. Dig into your hearts, into your souls. In 1992, May 1992, up the road, David referred to it, I gave a speech on the poverty of values and made the outlandish, outrageous, hugely controversial statement that it would be in the best interest of our children to be born and raised in an intact family. Now, 1996, that no longer seems controversial. Doesn't matter whether you're Republican or Democrat, liberal, conservative, we have a new consensus that, of course, that's the best interest of our children. That doesn't mean that single mothers or single fathers don't love their children, care for their children. My mother was raised by a single mother because my grandmother and grandfather were divorced, and my mother turned out just fine. But we were talking about the model and what we should aspire to. And you can remember the abuse and the controversy and the criticism that came my way, but look at what we were talking about then and talking about today. Our culture, the poverty of values. Look at the crisis in public education today. Meryl and I are products of public education. Our children went to public schools more than private schools. But look at the crisis that we have today. In Indianapolis, in most of the public schools, metal detectors. I think back when I was going to school, our teachers, they were concerned about what? Like chewing gum? I can remember over and went to Scottsdale High School, slamming your locker door. I mean, that was a no-no. You got sent to the principal's office, running. Dress codes in Huntington. Yeah, dress codes. Those are the big issues. That's what teachers, parents, principals were concerned about. Look at what they're concerned about today. Gangs, guns, violence, drugs. And look at the drug use today, especially our teenagers. What is it? It's on the rise again. In this country, the greatest country in the world, 5,000 abortions every single day. 12-year-olds being tried in adult court for murder. A welfare culture of dependency that robs people of their dignity and self-respect. And yes, an epidemic of illegitimacy so dramatic that my friends, under current trends, think of this, under current trends, by the year 2010, one half of our children will be born into homes without fathers. One half. And it's not just the father missing, the fathers, brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, parents, grandparents, one half of that family is not around. One half gone. And so when someone asks, why do we always have to talk about the culture and about values, I point to the cultural indicators, and I say, that's why. Last year, a woman from New Hampshire handed me a thought-provoking item from her local newspaper. I'd like to share it with you, and it reads as follows. The average age of the world's great civilizations has been 200 years. They have progressed through these sequences, from bondage to spiritual faith. From spiritual faith to great courage. From great courage to liberty. From liberty to abundance. From abundance to selfishness. From selfishness to complacency. From complacency to apathy. From apathy to dependence. From dependence back to bondage again. It's a sobering progression to think about. But I've always believed, and I continue to believe, that America is different, and it will be a different country. We are people who learn from history, and there is much to learn from American history. Our nation has a deep religious heritage, and even the self-anointed experts can't argue with that. Our religious background is seen in some of the national songs that we sung here today. God Bless America, America the Beautiful, our national hymn written for the centennial celebration in 1876 is entitled God of Our Fathers. Our belief in the Creator is seen in other ways as well. Take a coin or a dollar out of your pocket. What does it say? In God we trust. That message is inscribed just above the speaker's chair in the House of Representatives. And I can assure you that it was not added after the 1994 elections. At the United States Supreme Court, the Ten Commandments. Yes, they are commandments, not suggestions. Are on the wall directly behind the chair of the Chief Justice. To many, including myself, this is incredibly ironic, especially when you read some of the rulings of the court when the issue of religion is before our justices. The first Thursday in May, what is it? The National Day of Prayer. This is an event that has gained increased attention in recent years, as many other traditions dealing with our religious beliefs has as well. Some historians have even written that America may be undergoing what they call the Fourth Great Awakening. And I believe there is something to this thesis. The argument and the knowledge is that we have had several great awakenings in our nation's history. The first began around 1760 and led to the American Revolution and the establishment of our republic. The second occurred in the early, mid-19th century and led to the abolition of slavery and the passage of constitutional amendments establishing equal rights for black Americans. The third Great Awakening was in the late 19th century and led to the labor movement, attacks on big business, advocacy of women's rights and civil rights, and ultimately the social foundation of modern America. The current Great Awakening is said to have begun around 1980. It is expressed in anti-government sentiments, tax revolts, the pro-life movement, mothers against drunk driving, and a re-emphasis on personal responsibility and accountability. In many ways, the current Great Awakening, or revival, if you like that term better, is the result of the events of the last several decades. 30 years, my friends, of well-intentioned social engineering have only led to more social breakdown, not to mention a bankrupt federal treasury. Today, even the most liberal politicians declare that the era of big government is over. We have a new consensus that government isn't the answer to our problems. But does that mean government is going to disappear? Of course not. Our government still has legitimate functions, from defending our country to protecting our God-given rights and to preserving the free enterprise system and our freedoms. But as the role of government is scaled back, new questions emerge. Whose job is it to reverse the breakdown of civic virtue? Whose job is it to undo the damage left by the culture of dependency and big government? Whose job is it to rebuild the foundations of faith, family, integrity, and responsibility? My friends, it's our job. That is our challenge. And as we look to the future, I believe it is time to focus once again on the real agents of compassion. Our families, our volunteer organizations, our communities of faith. That's where our compassion is. Fortunately, examples across this great nation are plentiful. In Washington, D.C., right under the noses of the so-called experts, lies the gospel mission on Fifth Street. They offer soup, soap, and salvation to the homeless. The drug addiction program at the Gospel Mission is far more effective than the government program located 3 blocks away, even though the government program spends about 20 times as much money. 2 years ago, I visited a USA Harvest facility in Memphis, Tennessee. You may not be familiar with USA Harvest, but it is a volunteer national network of food banks founded by a very good friend of mine, Stan Curtis, in Louisville, Kentucky. And in Memphis, this food is collected and it is distributed by a local mission. And when I visited the mission, I introduced myself to the people there. And I'll never forget this one gentleman that I met, and he came up to me and he looked very frail. And he had been through many problems. And he told me how he had come to this mission, a broken man, financially, emotionally, and spiritually. He told me, he says, I had nothing when I came here. He had lost complete hope. He was on the verge of depression or even worse. But the mission, he said, and the harvest, they gave him a new start in life. And he looked at me and he said, I want you to take a close look at my eyes and my face. And I did. And he says, I don't look very well, do I? And I said, well, I think things are going to be just fine. I'm glad that you're here. He says, no, I don't look well, do I? He says, I may not look strong on the outside, but sir, he said, today, because of this mission, I am strong on the inside. And I looked at him and I said, why? He says, because I know God. And here is one person, totally hopeless, out of luck, total despair. And here is a volunteer organization with a component of faith, reaching out, not only clothing him, feeding him, counseling him, but saving him. Think of how many millions of people are touched by faith-based charities throughout our country. In this fourth Great Awakening, perhaps we are experiencing the beginnings of a spiritual revival. Religion, my friends, it's not a hobby. It is the essence of what life and death are all about. And it is at the very heart of our nation's founding. I am reminded of a comment I read a year or so ago by one of our country's leading experts on crime. And he says, once you get right down to it, the real hope and the only hope for overcoming the crime and the epidemic of crime in this country is religion. He said that is our only hope. And if he is correct, and I believe he is, then it is more important than ever that we decrease the level of hostility to religion in the public square. I will repeat, the First Amendment, which guarantees our freedom of religion, was written to protect religion from government influence, not the other way around. But today, so often our culture gets it backwards, somehow suggesting that the First Amendment is designed to protect government from the influence of religion. I tell you, God help us the day our government and our culture are not influenced by religion. Faith is important to every one of us this morning. Faith and prayer have certainly worked wonders for me and Marilyn and our family. In a long political career, nothing has given me more strength and reassurance than the knowledge that people on a daily basis, many in this church, were praying for me, for my family. And just last week, a person called my office, didn't leave her name, spoke to the receptionist, and said, I just want you to know that I pray for Dan and Marilyn Quayle and his family every single day. That lady, wherever she is, she will never know how much that meant to me, because I believe in the power of prayer. And as I look to the future, I can think of nothing more appropriate to say, especially as we have celebrated the freedom that God has given us this morning, than to say, God bless America. He certainly has in the past, and if we choose rightly, he will in the future. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful Sunday. enjoy your families, and thank you for inviting me. And God bless each and every one of you. Thank you.
I'm going to ask my friend and fellow pastor John Maxwell to come and lead us in prayer as we close. I want to thank you again. This has been a marvelous service. We're so blessed to have had you here, and I trust that this will make a lasting impression in your heart and cause you to want to pray for the events of these next days, that faith and courage will prevail. Let us bow together in prayer.
Father, we thank you so much for this experience of listening to a patriot, a man of God. Help us to understand how to have faith and courage. I pray your blessings upon him and his family. I pray your blessings upon Shadow Mountain, upon David and his leadership, upon our country. God bless America. Amen.